169 is no stranger to this committee. It has been introduced a number of times by the former now Senator John Bell. House Bill 169 adds correctional officers to the list of the public safety employees who are entitled to a presumption that hypertension, heart disease, and certain infectious disease are occupational diseases compensable under the Workman's Compensation Act. In Virginia, presently, there's about 6,500 correctional officers in Virginia. Virginia is also addressing a 1,000 correctional officer shortage. These individuals work in a most unsafe work environment with disease and infection, criminal, violent gang members, and drug addicts, just to name a few. There are many occasions that officers have been bitten, surrounded by inmates with TB and hepatitis C, and other disease carrying out their work responsibilities each day. Correctional officers are the only public safety officers that are not covered for communicable diseases that they may be exposed on their job under the Virginia Workman's Compensation Act. Firefighters, state police, sheriffs, deputy sheriffs, ABC enforcement officer, campus police officers at universities, just to name a few, all of these are included under this statute, all except correctional officers. As I indicated, this piece of legislation has been introduced by Senator John Bell for a number of years, and I hope that committee will pass the bill today. I do have some representatives here to speak to the committee at the appropriate time.
Yes, members of the committee, if you have any questions for the patron. Any individuals wishing to speak in support of the legislation?
Okay. First, I have Mr. Donna Bell with the National Coalition of Public Safety Officers, who will provide a brief presentation. But I also have many correctional officers here present, representing other facilities all across the Commonwealth. And at this time, I would like them to stand. Mr. Donna Bell.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. I am a 27-year veteran of the Department of Corrections. I retired in 2007, and I have walked those beats, I've been in those units. I worked every kind of post you can imagine, wearing their uniform. And what these folks are facing are things that most members of this body, and especially those from the general public, can hardly imagine. They face some conditions that people would not want their pet to suffer, much less a human being. And I want you to use imagination for a minute, if you would. Think about yourself walking into a unit, and right out of the blue, you have a person that throws human waste in your face. At that moment, you don't have any idea what this person has, is carrying, or anything of that nature. But you do know that you have just been struck by something that's gonna wear with you, not after you go and get checked out and get cleaned up, but it's probably gonna wear with you the rest of your career in this business. This is a dangerous environment, and these people face conditions that most people cannot imagine. We are concerned with one portion of this legislation, and that is to give them protection for presumption to infectious diseases. There are only two public safety, uniform public safety groups that's not covered under presumption. That are correctional officers and some agents of the DMV. But these folks, if anybody should have protection for infectious disease, we believe that this is the group, yet for so long they have not been covered, and we are asking that you members of the committee would support this legislation. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a couple more minutes for individuals that are speaking in support. Maybe
you have to
save time for those individuals behind you.
Of course. Thank you for your time. I just want to say that along with these public safety groups, the first responders are covered by this. Okay, we are the first responders. We have to take that consideration. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Bridget Squire, correctional officer. I'm a field training officer on my job. And one of the things that I teach the officers in training is to practice on keeping their hands clean at all times. Because what we deal with on our job, we have to constantly go in and out doors. We have guys who go get their fingerprint for diabetics. They go on in and out the door as well. Sometimes you're at home, you're working, you might have a prick or cut on your hand, and then you go to work the next day. We have had officers who have contracted some things at work, and they were instructed by human resource to prove you got it here. Well, the environment in which we work in, this is what we are faced with every day, and some. So we're asking you guys to please support this. We have been here several years asking for your support on this bill, and I'm asking for you guys to please support this bill because we really need it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is James Murdoch. I'm a correctional officer. I'd just like to say, thank you all for taking the time to review this. This is what we need. We go through different trials every day. And due to HIPAA, there's things that we're not going to know about. And by the time we do know, it may be too late. So this bill will greatly help us and many others. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Izzy Gallagher. I've been a correctional officer for almost 13 years now. And I've been exposed to all different amount of things. I've got blood splatter on me from breaking up a fight. Also keep in mind, we have to search these individuals on a daily basis. We also have to go search their property, which they could have any amount of things that could stick us, like things they use to get tattoos with. And we could be exposed to any number of communicable diseases and take that and carry that with us for the rest of our lives. So we really would appreciate you supporting this bill.
Members of the committee, Sean Gallant, Virginia Police Benevolent Association, representing 6,000 law enforcement professionals across the state, many of which are corrections officers. We want to let you know we support this bill.
Any individuals here to speak in opposition of this final piece of legislation? Seeing none.
They do go on an examination, yes, sir. And then even when they are exposed to some of the diseases, they have to file a claim, and then they also have to seek medical treatment as well as a prevention mechanism.
If this is acted upon favorably, it would need to go to appropriations. So again, Chair, entertain the motion. Yes,
thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would move to recommend reporting and referral to the Committee on Appropriations.
Second.
There's a motion and properly seconded to report and refer. Members will report to the vote in just one moment.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the subcommittee.
My bill is House Bill 805, and I'll just give you a brief description of it. It relates to the protection of employees, standards for heat illness prevention. And before I even get started, because it will be quite abbreviated, because I have learned that there are two other members who have similar bills, and so instead of acting on my bill, I would like for it to be passed by for the day, so we can have an opportunity to meet together, the rest of us, so we can come up with one bill that everyone can agree with. But I'll explain to you the bill. What the issue is Virginia workers suffer from heat stress and related illnesses, but protection under the current state law are sparse and we believe insufficient. So, but despite the warnings that Commonwealth of Virginia has not had a comprehensive, effective occupational heat standard. So what this bill does is just calls for a simple solution such as water rash shade and other measures such as that. So at this time, as I said, because there are other delegates with similar bills, I would like to pass it by. However, you don't know these things until the last day. And people have already traveled quite a distance to come here. So if it's your will, I'd like for some farm workers who are here from the Eastern Shore to give you a chance to provide a little testimony and some of their thoughts on the bill.
Yeah, and if you don't mind, I would love to hear the testimony and let the discussion flow and then make a determination rather than go back for the day. We'll move it on to full with the opportunity for you to work with those individuals that feel strongly about the legislation to address any of those concerns or prior to full. But members of any questions for the patron? Those here to speak in favor of this legislation.
Mr. Chair, committee members, I'm Jason Urashis. I'm the Farm Worker Program Coordinator with the Legal Aid Justice Center. So I've spent the last 3 years traveling the Commonwealth and meeting with workers, including but not limited to farm workers, often on late nights and weekends, to connect them to resources, listen to issues, and hear about their life and work experiences. Almost universally, one of the most common complaints, if not the most common complaint from workers, is being overworked in the heat. They have stories of workers, other workers who have passed out, workers who have been worked to the bone without breaks or water, even workers who have died. We listen to the workers, and what do they want? They want heat stress protections. They want employer training on the issue. They want breaks, shade, and water. And they want a way to enforce their rights in a scenario where there's already a noteworthy power imbalance. This bill addresses those workers' concerns. It requires common sense regulations for the benefit of both the workers doing some of the most difficult work in Virginia and the benefit of the economy by having a healthy workforce. The Army, Navy, Marines, and Air Force all have heat illness standards. Some states have likewise stepped up to the plate to protect vulnerable workers. Virginia should be next. Along with the Virginia Conservation League of Voters, as well as the Virginia Clinicians Network, I helped to draft this bill, and I appreciate the subcommittee's consideration. I'll be available for questions. And I want to introduce briefly my colleague Manuel Gago, who's a farm worker organizer with our team, as well as Blasi Guerrero, who has traveled from the Eastern Shore. She's an agricultural worker, and she'd like to speak on the issue. So, thank you.
Buenas tardes, señor delegado y miembro de la mesa del comité de la Cámara de Representantes. Mi nombre es Blasi Guerrero y vengo representando a los trabajadores del campo del Eastern Shore, Virginia. Y vengo a hablarles de la importancia de apoyar a la ley HB 805.
Good afternoon, Mr. Speaker, delegates, member of the committee. My name is Blasi Guerrero. I came to representing farm workers of the Eastern Shore of Virginia and came here to talk about the importance of to support the law HB 805.
Trabajar de 12 horas.
been sitting working for some hours even under AC, but also we're working 12-14 hours under the sun, and even not have any breaks to take a lunch. We have no place to eat or food with dignity, and not even take a break after hours and hours under the sun.
Cuando ya está muy tarde o que está lloviendo, a veces para ustedes no es fácil, no es nada fácil cuando ustedes van a la tienda y compran una hilera de tomate, compran una lechuga, van al restaurante y comen una ensalada, pero no saben el proceso que lleva de las manos de quien lo está cultivando desde que comienza la plantación.
Sometimes you don't have idea how the process is when you go to the salad in a restaurant, or go to the supermarket to pick a tomato or a lettuce, how farm workers work so hard to plant the seed, even when they're picking the plant.
Cuando es en el mes de mayo, en el mes de junio, está el calor a 110, en ese lugar se siente como a 120. No sabes lo que es sentir la cara hinchada, así, que tú sientes que te vas a desmayar. Pero no puedes tomar un break, porque tu patrón te dice que tienes que trabajar. Y yo recuerdo que me dicen mis compañeros, Flasi, tómate un descanso. No le dicen que te regañen. A veces digo yo, mañana no vengo a trabajar, porque está bien caliente el sol. Pero recuerdo que vienen los files, que viene el regreso a la escuela en agosto, que mis tres hijos tienen que regresar a la escuela. Y por un momento me olvido de lo cansado.
So sometimes during May and June, and with 110 degrees, you feel like maybe it's only 120 degrees, and you feel your face like a swelling, and it's so hard, and your workers say, hey, maybe you need to take a rest. You can't work so hard. And sometimes, maybe I need to take a rest. Maybe tomorrow is very hot. I will not when I came to work. But I remember I have bills. My kids need to go to school. And now that pain, that feel when working, I need to forget about that. So yeah, I need to for a 6 a.m. prepare my lunch to eat over there. And the only help we have is like with the sun come down because it's no more heat. That's the only way we have to rest.
Y al otro día te levantas. Lo mismo, de lunes a domingo. Pero cuando te levantas al otro día, sientes que se te quebra la cintura. Porque todo el tiempo, todo el día estás agachado. No es nada fácil. Trabajando bajo el sol 12-14 horas y sin tener un descanso, sin tener cómo tomar agua limpia, porque a veces los contratistas no te ponen agua. Si tú llevas agua, está el día muy caliente, muy largo, te la terminas. Y si hay agua, tomas, y si no, no hay. Muchas de las veces no puedes, tienes que comer, pero sin lavarte las manos. Las verduras, el tomate, tiene químicos. Nosotros nos enfermamos. Pero a veces este trabajo es el trabajo más grande que pueda haber aquí. Y de eso muchas personas dicen que les venimos a quitar el trabajo. Pero no es así. Lo único que hacemos es sacar adelante nuestra familia.
Thank you.
So yeah, sometimes it's hard. Like we don't have any way to take a rest. Even like you go there to work, not have any time. Water, clean water. The only way you bring your water, but it's been so hot, maybe after a few hours you have no more water. And not even you have water to wash your hands. And you know all the chemicals, the herbicides they use in the plantation, and that get in our system and we get diseases. So I ask you to support this law to protect the workers.
Thank you for listening.
working under these extreme conditions. What she just described, I wanted to apologize. It's human exploitation. I couldn't believe that there are Virginians that are working under these circumstances, and it has taken us years to bring this lady up here in front of us. We are number one in the agribusiness industry, and treating the farmers who have put us in this situation is unacceptable, Mr. Chairman, and I would like to thank the patron and the lady for coming here today.
Thank you.
Una pregunta, una cosa más le voy a decir un poquito. Pues yo los invito a que ustedes un día puedan llegar a Listing Show, donde se cultiva el tomate. El trabajo comienza ahorita en marzo. El proceso es largo porque tienen que preparar la tierra, tienen que poner el plástico y después la plantación, la estaca, el amarre. Y para el 4 de julio, que la mayoría de ustedes o la mayoría de las oficinas está cerrado porque es un día festivo, ese día, nosotros es el día que piscamos el tomate, que para nosotros no hay descanso, no hay día festivo para nosotros. El único día que nos puede, que nos salva es la noche, porque desde que comienza la pizca no paramos. Gracias.
So to finish, I want to invite us to anyone delegate to want to come to the Eastern Shore to see all the process of plantation of tomatoes. It starts right now in March and ends by end of like October. But you know, the most important day for us, that many of you are maybe celebrating, maybe it's not our day, it's 4th of July. That's the first day to start the picking, and we know stop day till October, so we finish. So we invite you, if you wanna come to the Eastern Shore and see what is the condition of the workers during that over there. Right now, it's not picking, it's not agriculture because it's winter, so I'm working now in another job. It's not picking season, so there's no, because during the winter, it's no planting or something in the agricultural business, so I'm working in another type of job right now.
Is she working?
Yes.
So right now, she's not.
She's not working in the agricultural business right now. Legal aid justice centers, she's only like activist, and she's part of the activists on the Eastern Shore that organize talk about workers' rights over there.
Subcommittee Kyle Shreve, Executive Director of the Virginia Agribusiness Council. We have
full. She's already offered for it to go back for the day, but I would prefer that it move on full. Is this something that you all think you can live with and work with the chair as we move to full?
As I said, Mr. Chair, members of the subcommittee, that we look forward to having that conversation. Again, I don't know that it can be accomplished within the existing framework that was built. We always hesitate to try to move it forward and then have to pull it back. But understanding that, we would hope that we would be able to work it out through regulation or trying to have some type of an enacted clause that we could work it out with. I'm happy to work with her on it. Generally, we like that to happen before it moves forward rather than as the process moves forward. But I think that's a little bit.
And I will say this, the bill is, from talking to my colleagues, is going to go forward. And so I would like not to stop the train and to keep it moving. I would hope that you all would be willing to work with the chair. And it doesn't need to go on the next docket, but we would like to get it out of this so that you all can get moving on.
Understood, Mr. Chair. And I would say that I leave that to the will of the committee, but my members asked me to raise the concerns that we have on behalf of my members, and I've done so.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. Madam.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
Is there time for more questions?
Yes, it is.
Patrick.
Is now the time?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Are you familiar with any federal regulations on labor and hours worked and the break times that are mandated?
I am somewhat familiar, but I wouldn't want to speak as an expert on the topic at this point. But if you have a question, I can research it and get it back to you. But I wouldn't say I am an expert on it.
Is it okay, we're speaking to the bill at the perfect time?
Okay, well,
thank you, Mr. Chairman. I gotta admit, this bill, the whole concept, really gives me a lot of concern. I certainly appreciate the testimony, but we do in fact have labor laws, federal laws.
work hours, you know, even when they're driving back to the plant to get another load. On an average day, a driver may sit in the driver's lounge, you know, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, half an hour, not doing anything, waiting until they go back out. On an extremely busy day, they would come back in the plant, get in line with the other trucks, and get loaded and go out to the next job site. And so, you know, we're not required to, even to, you know, under the federal guidelines, we're not even required to have to give a lunch break if it's outside of certain hours. But we, again, there we're limited on the number of hours that they can be on, you know, be clocked in, if you will, and working in any given work day. So, you know, it gets pretty complicated at that point.
Are you making the argument for or against? It sounds like you're helping to make the argument for, I think. Are you arguing for or against this legislation?
No, I'm arguing against
it. Oh, okay.
The fact that there's industries out there that don't work 9 to 5. You know, so that's really hard to put it in a box to try to say that you've got to have you know, a set break every certain period of time. It's very difficult. Okay.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
I just want to mention that this is for everyone in the Commonwealth, not just concrete dealers. There are other people. As a matter of fact, we've had 100 non-fatal injuries, heat strokes, and those types of things. And a matter of fact, there's been 3 fatalities caused by heat exposure. So maybe it's not in your industry, but there are other people who work in extreme heat. And so those are the ones that we're trying to address. And it's not like your whole crew has to stop right there at that moment. Somebody is suffering some type of heat exposure, discomfort, or whatever. If that person would be allowed to step away, get water, and that type of thing. So I'm not trying to hurt any one business, and that's the reason why I wanted to have a chance for all of us to get together and talk about it. But it's not just your business we're looking at. We're looking at the entire Commonwealth and anyone who works in those conditions. We got people working in factories also that suffer from extreme heat exposure. So those people we're looking at also. And that's the reason why I'm hoping that we can all get together, have a discussion, see if we can have a meeting of the minds and come back with something that's agreed upon.
Madam Chair, as we listen to the discussion, I would love to give
This bill is a ombudsman for the exception, ombudsman for the Workers' Compensation Commission. Virginia has a high percentage of injured workers who attempt to navigate through the comp system without attorneys, and believe me, that's not a good thing to do. And the commission even has a call center, but they can only give limited information. Once a case is referred to the hearing docket, the commission is limited in how it communicates with the litigants because of ex parte communication rules. So this results in many pro se litigants showing up at a hearing and are being informed that they got certain things they haven't filed, et cetera, and the case is continued. So what this does is sets up this ombudsman program. JLARC has recognized the need for the ombudsman program, and it's set up sort of like some of the other ombudsman statutes that we already have, like the Office of Managed Care Ombudsman, Small Business Ombudsman, Virginia Victims Fund Ombudsman, and Mr. Chairman, I do have a couple people here, or just maybe one person here to testify for it that I've worked with on this bill. So it's a simple bill, just setting up some assistance for those who are represented by attorneys. Yes.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair. Andy Ryan and my colleague Jim Munson and I are both here to speak on behalf of the bill. By way of introduction, Jim and I are among a number of other attorneys who founded the statewide Virginia Workers' Comp Inn of Cork, which has about 230 lawyers, defense lawyers, plaintiff lawyers, and judges. And we have created within the Inner Court an advisory conference, which is a workers' comp version of Boyd Gray's, if you're familiar with that conference. And what we have intended to do through our advisory conference collaboratively is put together some useful legislation from time to time. This is our first opportunity for Jim and I, on behalf of this bipartisan group of lawyers on both sides of the comp, have come up with something that the commission thinks is important, to do something for workers statewide. It so happens, as Delegate Kilgore mentioned, approximately 40% of injured workers are not represented. The problem is a lot of these folks call the commission. The commission has difficulty giving advice to them because that would be an unauthorized practice of law. So the commission needs to have a vehicle to create an ombudsman who is a lawyer who has certain opportunities to say things that are helpful to the pro se folks. This legislation was drafted collaboratively, defense lawyers, plaintiff lawyers, and judges, and Jim and I. Jim is the current president of the statewide Inn of Cork. He's a defense lawyer, I'm a plaintiff lawyer, and I'm proud to say we are here together in support of this legislation along with the commission.
Thank you. And I'll only add that this really doesn't benefit Andy and his practice of law, particularly with respect to representation of claimants, or our side with respect to defense. It really just helps
would like to first begin. This is House Bill 121, Workers' Compensation, and I would like to move an amendment in nature of a substitute. Mr. Chairman, this bill in its entirety serves to add the cancers of colon, brain, and testes to the list of cancers that are presumed to be an occupational disease covered by the Virginia Workers' Compensation Act, where firefighters and certain employees develop the enumerated cancers. This bill was sent to JLARC for a study in 2019. The JLARC study concluded in December 2019 what our firefighters have been saying for some time. According to the JLARC study, the statutory requirement to prove contact with a toxic substance that caused the firefighter's cancer is, quote, unreasonably burdensome and possibly counter to legislative intent, end quote. Despite the best protective gear and cancer prevention, education, and activities, firefighters are 65% more likely to contract cancer than the general population and have a 14% increased risk of dying from cancer. But sadly, too many firefighters are contracting cancer linked to the profession without receiving any benefits for themselves and their families due to the present language in the code. In 2019 alone, more than four states, Texas, Florida, Alabama, and Tennessee, passed legislation to provide enhanced cancer benefits to their firefighters. The time is now for Virginia to do the same. Some of the stakeholder support includes Virginia Fire Chiefs Association, Virginia State Police Association, Virginia Professional Firefighters, Virginia State Firefighters Association, Virginia Association of Governmental EMS Administrators, and so on. Firefighters and law enforcement officers and emergency personnel every day save lives, and we now have the opportunity to save theirs.
You have an individual here to speak in support of your legislation?
I do.
Fires without thinking twice to save children, people, pets,
mentor for the Firefighter Cancer Support Network. I work with families here in the state of Virginia that are going through cancer, and I deal with the spouses of those that have passed on. I am taking classes at Liberty University in pastoral care. I'm taking crisis intervention classes as well, because we need this help. We need to look after our firefighters. They put their lives on the line every day, going into spaces they have no clue what is going on. A small kitchen fire that you may think only smoked up your kitchen and burned up a pan has put off over 51,000 carcinogens. When he was on chemo, the pills, our copay was $3,400 a month. That was a copay after insurance. It doesn't take long to end up with nothing at all. And we had those long talks concerning the fact of when we had to pull the plug and say enough is enough because there was no money left. So please, I beg of you to go with this. Air firefighters need you.
Mr. Chair, my name is John Wright, President of the Frederick County Professional Firefighters of Winchester. For 6 years, firefighters have been coming before the General Assembly asking for help in fixing this broken workers' compensation system and broken cancer presumption law. For 6 years, we've appeared before you, and unfortunately, we haven't gotten all the way across the finish line. JLARC has reaffirmed everything that we've been sharing with you and all of our legislators, that the system is broken and is in need of reforms. This bill does that, and we ask that you pass it. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, so we have a question for John.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman? And I appreciate your visit to my office.
Yes.
And certainly, you know, for what you're working on here. And we had a brief conversation, and I was just curious that I've been thinking about that. So something's causing this, and, you know, firemen have a state-of-the-art equipment and so forth, but still there's a glitch somewhere. Is somebody looking at procedures, equipment, you know, what's being done to try to solve this that we can eliminate, if it's possible?
Sure. So there's other ways that toxins and carcinogens can enter the body other than through inhalation. Obviously, we wear a breathing apparatus when we're around hazardous materials or in smoke-filled environments. Absorption is another. When we're going to work, it's hot, obviously, in certain environments, we're sweating. Those toxins can seep through even state-of-the-art PPE and into our bloodstreams. And a matter of time when those toxins might pop up in the form of the cancer later in life. Fire departments all across the Commonwealth have taken enormous steps to get their hands around this issue and provide a second set of turnout gear so that the primary set can be washed of those toxins, carcinogens that are laced all over it. So the firefighter can wear that second set of gear while it's being cleaned. State-of-the-art breathing apparatus is up to speed. We're going gross decontamination on the scene to at least get the initial carcinogen toxins off the firefighter's gear. So there's numerous things that the firefighters and the fire departments and localities have done. There's still more that we can do. Diesel exhaust capture systems is a big one that we're exposed to. Diesel exhaust, if you do not know, is a known carcinogen. Obviously, firefighters are exposed to that every single day that they come to work, just being in fire station. So it's not just a matter of being exposed on a fire scene, but also in the fire stations that they work in. So I hope that may give you some clarity.
Mr. Chairman, Wayne Huggins, State Police Association. Our commercial vehicle enforcement officers and motor carrier safety troopers are covered by this bill, and we benefit from this added protection, and we, like the others, we very much appreciate your support, and thank you.
Thank you.
really to all five bills. I assume that, each one will be amended in the same fashion.
Yeah, well, we will amend the last one.
And we'll all the rest of them into it.
Yes.
But they'll all be the same. And I haven't seen the substitute. I have just one question. In the heart-lung section, did you put the five-year requirement?
Have you seen Senator Sasslaw's?
I have.
You've seen.
Okay, thank you very much. That's perfect. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Chris Legault for BML. I'm not here to oppose